All right, good morning, Year 12s. I hope you had a great weekend and had a smooth Monday and looking forward to getting into PE for the week. For today's lesson, we're going to be talking about momentum, summation of momentum, conservation of momentum, and we're going to touch on Newton's first law as well. You guys have all done your summary notes on this concept, so hopefully this is just a bit of a refresher for you. As always, I am open to questions. So, if there's a particular part that you don't understand, you'll get the opportunity to ask a question as part of our sort of exit slips, and I can re-record things with different examples as required. All right, let's get into it. So, momentum is the measure of the amount of motion an object has and its resistance to changing that motion. So, essentially, how hard it is to stop an object is probably the easiest way to try and think about that. Okay, and the reason for that is because we take into account the mass of that object. So if you have two balls coming towards you at the same speed, and one is really light and one is really heavy, the one that is heavier will have the larger momentum, okay, due to its mass. So velocity is essentially speed in a certain direction. If you're not moving, you have zero momentum, okay, because velocity would be equal to zero. So zero times anything will equal zero, so therefore you have zero momentum. So here is just an example that I just said. If you have a cricket ball and I hit it hard, so it's moving really quickly, or if I just try to block it, so it's moving slower, we know which one is easier to stop, the one that is moving slower. Okay, so even though in that situation the cricket ball had the same mass, because its velocity was different, all right, the one with the slower velocity will therefore have a lower momentum. Therefore, it is easier to change that motion of that object, which in that case would be to catch the ball. A really key point is that the body with the greater momentum will dominate the collision. So you don't have to be the heaviest person to have the highest momentum. So if you're playing football, just if you weigh, say, 100 kilos and everyone else weighs 60 kilos, that doesn't mean that every single time when you tackle someone, you'll be able to push them in the direction that you were running, because it becomes down to momentum, so what speed that they were running at. So if we look at this example here, and I think this example's in your book. So we've got a young man here, he's 90 k's, and he's traveling at 6 meters per second. And then we've got this guy here who is lighter, so 10 kilos lighter, and he is 80 kilos and he's traveling at 7 meters per second. So if we do some, let's see how well I can go with writing here. So if we do mass times velocity, 90 times 6 equals 54. Okay, and then here, 80 times 7 equals 56. So he has a higher momentum, blue guy. So therefore, when they hit each other, they're actually going to go in the direction of the blue guy because he has the high momentum. All right, so that's it in a nutshell. Let me know if you have any questions in particular about that, but you're about to do some questions from your book, so that will force you to sort of really think about that. We then move on to conservation of momentum, which is probably one of the harder examples to talk about. Because there can be other things at play that we don't really think about in study design. That sounds a bit confusing, but hopefully this will make sense in a second. The conservation of momentum means that this total momentum of the objects before the collision will equal the momentum after the collision. Okay, so I'm going to read through this green writing here, and then we're going to do the hockey example on the next page, and I'm going to give you guys some fake numbers to hopefully help with your understanding. So it says here, consider a hockey ball, all right, so on the ground, okay, and it's stationary, so the ball is not moving. The momentum in that ball, because there is zero velocity, is equal to zero. The momentum of the hockey stick is mass times velocity. All right, and that total momentum of the two objects before the collision is just whatever the hockey stick value is. And as I said, I'll go through that in the next page. When they then hit, so say the momentum, I keep saying I'm not going to do this and then I do it. So say the momentum was 60 before they hit, it would be 60 after they hit. But because the sticks stop moving, that momentum moves onto the ball. All right, if you can imagine that you are hitting a hockey ball, so you've got a hockey stick in your hand and you hit a hockey ball, you know that you swing this stick relatively quickly, Okay, but when you hit the ball, it goes way quicker than what your hockey stick was going at. Okay, and that's because of this principle here. All right, so after the collision, the ball moves off very quickly with a really high velocity, and the stick slows to zero velocity at the end point of the follow-through. The total momentum after the collision is equal to the momentum of the ball. And this is the key concept here. Let me find my little highlighter. Okay, because the stick has a greater mass than the ball, okay, the velocity of the ball must have been higher than the velocity of the stick pre-collision. So let's talk about this here. All right. So we have a stick, okay? Let's say I'm going to make up numbers just to make it easier for us. So say the stick is 100 grams. I've got no idea how much it would be. Okay, and it's going at, let's say, 4 meters per second. Okay, so therefore, okay, 100 times 4, it's going the momentum of 400. Okay, so that's the stick. The ball we know is zero. So therefore, the total momentum prior to the collision is 400. Okay, let's draw a line down here. Okay, so then the ball hits the stick hits the ball. Okay, and now it said that the stick stopped moving by the end of the follow-through. So we know that this momentum still needs to equal 400. Okay, this ball only weighs 10 kilos, 10 grams. Okay, so it only weighs 10 grams. So if I know that 10 times something needs to equal 400. All right. You won't ever be required to calculate this. This is just an example to get it into your head to make you realize why the ball moves quicker. Okay, so this is the grams, this is the weight. Okay, so 10 times something equals 400. Okay, and for those who love maths like me, I know that that number is 40. Okay, because 4 times 1 is 4, 2 zeros, so therefore it's 400. So therefore, my ball is now going at 40 meters per second. So it's going 10 times faster, okay, than what my stick was going. All right. So the reason why it's going faster is because it has a much smaller mass, and we know that momentum equals mass times velocity. So if my mass was a lot smaller, therefore the velocity or the speed of which that object was moving is a lot quicker. Okay. So hopefully that makes a little bit of sense for you. Happy to give another example if needed. Two more concepts to go through. Summation of momentum. Okay, so that essentially says here, if you have a good summation of momentum, you probably can throw or kick an object further. So what you do is you transfer your momentum from body part to body part, from start to finish. And the better you do that, the more momentum you'll be able to produce, and therefore the object that you're throwing, as I said, or hitting or kicking, will go further. For example, in golf, if you're trying to hit the ball as far as you can, okay, we want your golf head, okay, as it says here, club head, didn't know that's what it was called. All right, we want that to be going as fast as it can when it connects with the ball. All right, for that to happen, you need to make sure that your summation of momentum, so essentially how well your body is moving, okay, all comes together with all of these things. So I want you to almost imagine yourself hitting a golf ball. So you'll know, so pretend you're standing there right now. You're two feet shoulder width apart. You reach behind you. You've got the golf club in your hand. Okay, you twisted your torso right around. And then as you swing through, you're twisting your torso back. All right, your legs are slightly bent because it's absorbing some of that force. You're swinging through and your arms are moving quicker and quicker until you hit that ball. Okay, the better that you can time that or coordinate that, okay, the more velocity that you will have on an object, okay, and that is what we want. So we know that the athletes, like, God, I can't speak, expert people in their field, that's not a great example, are going to be elite. There it is written right in front of me. Elite athletes, okay, are going to be really good at specific movements. That explains summation of momentum, okay. when we talk about how far we want something to go, so even like if you're doing like a, is it, what kind of kick is it in American football where they try and punt it as far as they can? So the way that they approach the ball and kick the ball, that would be a good example of summation of momentum. Just throwing the ball as far as you can. Again, American football, we've got your quarterback throwing really far. The way that he coordinates his body movements will allow him to throw the ball as far as he wants. Just a couple of key principles that allow this to occur. So you guys would do this without even realizing. Okay, so let's just think about the overarm throw. So you activate your strongest and larger muscles first. So when we think about the throw, okay, if you're trying to throw really far, your legs will be a little bit bent, you'll have engaged like your quads, your hammies, and your glutes, okay, because you're going to use them to push as you twist around. You're using all of your torso muscles, you're using your back muscles, you're using your shoulder muscles, okay? You try and use as many body parts as possible. So if you did nothing with your legs, if you didn't put one foot in front of the other and push through your legs, you would not throw the ball as far. Okay, so if you just tried to throw the ball using your shoulder and your arm, okay, that would go much less of a distance. You then transfer the momentum from one body part to another at maximum velocity. So there's no point if you're doing an overarm throw that you twist with your legs and your torso, you stop and then you keep going with your shoulder and your arm movement. Okay, so you need to make sure you're doing it in the right timing. Okay, and then you move from stronger and larger muscles to smaller muscles. So when you think about the last muscles that you're activating with your throw, you're moving through your shoulder, your arm, and your fingertips as you've sort of flicked that ball off your fingers. So we've gone from really large body parts, your legs, your torso, your shoulder, your back, and then you're moving right down to your biceps, triceps, fingertips, etc. Okay, you need to make sure that you do an appropriate follow through too. Okay, so hopefully that makes sense. You would do, as I said, you would do this already for lots of different movements that you guys feel like you're quite good at. Okay, I'm going to keep explaining some things, but you need to go back to these chapter checkup questions, and that will be what the work that you start to do once you finish listening to this video. A couple of more things I just wanted to show you. Newton's first law, we wanted to mention at this point in time because we're going to start talking about that a little bit more. We've already done the third law. So the first law, an object will stay at complete rest or continue to travel in the same direction at a constant velocity unless acted on by an unbalanced force. Okay, so we know when we talked about projectile motion that the ball would continue to go into the air forever, okay, but therefore gravity, all right, acts on it. Okay. Some examples here. So a soccer ball won't move from its position until a player kicks it. A tennis ball will continue traveling the direction of the serve until the player at the other end hits a force and applies a force, sorry, and hits it back. Okay. All right. I just wanted to go through because I feel like some of you guys are like, well, God, where are we sort of at? And I just wanted, this is from the study design, and I'm just going to highlight the things that we have already gone through. Okay, and as I've in my answers to some of your questions, I recommended that you start making mini posters on each of the dot points to study design. So we started with classification of movement skills. Ooh, okay, we've done all of these. So that was where we started. Okay, next one, influences of movement, including individual tasks and environmental constraints. We have done that. The link between motor skill development, participation, performance. So we know that the more we have skill development, the more we're going to participate, the higher our performance, the higher performance, the more we're going to develop our skill, etc. We have done qualitative movement analysis where we actually did one ourselves. All right, so then we talk about some of the biomechanical principles. We've done one and we've also done three. Okay, we've talked a little bit about mass, force, and momentum. We've touched on these, but not really. So we haven't done too much of those, but we've definitely done projectile motion. Okay, we've done levers. Okay, we've done direct and constraints-based approaches to constructions. We've done sociocultural factors. We've done the three stages of learning. We've done feedback, and we've touched on. Oh, where did my thing go? All right, I don't know why it won't let me highlight. Sorry, there we go. We've done feedback and we've touched on practice, but we're going to do a prac on that a little bit later. So we've done a fair bit. So if I were you, I'd be writing notes or just key points that are relevant to the study design so you guys know where we're at. So we've got done a bit, but we've got a little bit to go still. Okay. So once you finish this, can you go back to this slide, which is also a new book. I'll write the page number and start to do those questions, and I'll give you further instruction.